Hi, I'm Mike Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer. Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell is suffering from a serious health problem, but his aides, even the Capitol physicians, are refusing to acknowledge that there's a problem, even though we can see it clearly. Crime has become so bad in parts of California that a city councilman was recently robbed while he was talking to reporters about the growing crime problems in California. And could Hunter Biden end up being the man who brings down President Biden's re-election campaign? New reports suggest both ways. We're not sure. We'll talk about it. All that and more, it's coming up. Don't go anywhere. America's Lawyer starts right now. Mitch McConnell froze up again while talking to reporters last week, marking the second time in the last few weeks that he's had an episode. But what's interesting is that in both instances, his staffers didn't seem surprised at what happened. They didn't rush him to the hospital. They asked him what was wrong. Chances are they know exactly what's wrong. Otherwise, after an event like that, you would take him to the hospital immediately. Ring of Fire's Farron Cousins joins me to talk about what's happening, along with many other issues. Yeah, it's a pitiful story. I mean, he looks pitiful. Up there in front of the podium, he's barely hanging on. He's 81?
Yeah.
81 years old. Too old to be doing this. Whether the GOP says, well, he's still sharp, he's, you know, he's still brilliant, that's nonsense, okay? You look at it, it looks like early Parkinson's, doesn't it?
It really does. That's actually, you've got a lot of medical professionals, you know, the ones who go on TV regularly who are saying, listen, we obviously haven't examined him, but if we're looking just at the symptoms that are visible, this is Parkinson's, and they're all saying this is Parkinson's. And, you know, you bring up that great point of the fact that if we were standing here and I suddenly stopped responding, or you stopped responding, we would freak out.
Would you take me to the hospital, please?
Immediately. I wouldn't just be sitting here waiting for you to respond. Yeah. But his staffers looked like they almost expected it. So this was nothing new to them, which is a very telling thing.
I mean, two staffers sauntered up to him and talked to him, whispered. Look, if this were something that they didn't know, and, you know, having, you know, we're handling the Paraquat case, which is Parkinson's. We handled the, we've handled so many different cases that have been involved with welding cases. Those were Parkinson's disease. This is one of the early symptoms, and that's what they're talking about on television. I don't know. I'm not a doctor, but I've seen this before. And it you know, they say, well, it's possibly a seizure related to the belated concussion that took place. You know, I don't know. I'm not buying any of it. But the most telling thing is the staff, isn't it?
It is. That's what just shows you they're used to this. So what I'm willing to bet is that they've seen this more than just these two instances. Mm. I mean, these are people, they meet with him in his office, they, you know, drive him around. So if this is something that they've seen happen before and then, you know, 30, 60 seconds later he snaps out of it, you're not shocked. You know, nobody's eyes widened when this happened except for all the people in the crowd watching it. They could tell something was wrong. The staffers were almost annoyed by it. I mean, they just seemed like, okay.
This happened again.
And it's, listen.
Well,
McConnell, they're in trouble when he leaves because he has been leading, you know, some of the worst legislation we've seen, all the judicial picks. But that's all him. And he is their top fundraiser.
How
he went
Thune?
To a fundraiser
is,
that
is,
night.
Is Thune strong enough, his whip, his Republican whip? I don't think so.
I haven't seen that, but I get why Republicans want to hang on to him. And then I contrast that with, like, Feinstein.
Yeah.
Democrats have no reason. I mean, Feinstein's not a top fundraiser. She's not direct in policy, but they're still holding on to her, too.
She's basically a corpse at this point. I mean, they shuffle around and she's barely cognizant of what's going on around. But this is no different. I mean, the Democrats need the same message as the Republicans, okay? This guy's too old. He should be gone. We got a Democrat president that's getting ready to run again. He's too old. He should be gone. Feinstein needs to be gone. Pelosi needs to be gone. You know, I could go on both sides. It's just endless.
Yeah.
It's both sides. And we've talked about this before. The reason they don't go is because the money is so good.
It is.
Not what they're paid, but like we're going to talk about Nikki Haley, where Nikki Haley becomes a millionaire. Which she starts off with, doesn't even own a house, has no bank accounts, has no investments whatsoever. And then all of a sudden, overnight, she's a multimillionaire. That's why they stay. And that's the only reason they stay. And we need to make some tough decisions and say, no, you know what? It's time for you to get out of here, right? Yep. Nikki Haley saw the biggest bounce of any Republican candidate following the recent debate. And now that people are starting to take her seriously, they have questions about her massive sudden wealth. It's a crazy story. There's no way to ignore. She had literally no assets. She had no meaningful investments before. She was $1 million in debt. $1 million arguably in debt. She had $15,000 in her bank account. And she goes from pauper to millionaire. And you know how? Because she's the darling of the weapons industry. She's the person pushing Ukraine. She would invade Iran tomorrow if we gave her the opportunity. She wants to be president. She would be a war horse for the weapons industry. That's where she's made all this money.
Absolutely. And it's important that people understand this wasn't, oh, she made this money over 20 years. We're talking about within the last 5 or 6 years. Because she left the Trump administration either late 2017 or early 2018. And at that point, that's when she had $15,000, didn't own a home. And then suddenly, all these defense contractors and these defense groups said, hey, Nikki Haley, you don't have a job right now. Come sit on this board and we'll give you $300,000 a year. Come sit on this board, we'll give you $700,000 a year, even though you have no experience here, you have no expertise. But one of them was Boeing, right, where she sat on the board. And she did get called out for that. In the debate, Ramaswamy hit at her pretty hard when she was talking about all the, you know, foreign wars she would start. He said, I hope you enjoy your position on the Boeing and Lockheed boards.
She's living, before all this starts, she's living in a rental home, 2,000 square foot home, basically, rented. And now she's living in a $5 million mansion. What happened? What happened was she became the war pimp for the weapons industry. She's always talking about more money to Ukraine. Oh, we need to, and matter of fact, she's on a board, this really interesting board, that their whole focus is, you know, how do we start a war with Iran? Is there any other way to describe it?
No, that is exactly how it's been described. Because that's what they do. They look at this and they try to hype up, oh, Iran's going to have a nuclear weapon. If not tomorrow, then maybe next week or the week after, we've got to do something. But while she was ambassador to the UN, obviously she's making connections with all these other countries. So she's good friends with these other ambassadors. So how is that valuable to the weapons industry? Well, okay, you come sit on our board. Hey, remember your friend over in Saudi Arabia? Why don't you call them up? You know, we're trying to move some excess product over here. Why don't you call your friends over in Germany or call your friends in France, see if they want some of this material. She has the connections through the United Nations, her role there, which, right, again, was only a year.
Right.
But it was enough to get her these wonderful jobs.
Well, again, you wonder why these old folks stay. 81, 82, 84, you know, all these old politicians. Because it's a big moneymaker. You know, and if you look at, she's no different. And you know, there's no distinction. Everybody wants, oh, well, the Democrats are so different than the Republicans in that regard. Nonsense. She's a classic example of why these folks get into this business. You know what really killed me? She's talking about, oh, well, you know, Putin and Ukraine, and he's such an awful person. What about Saudi Arabia? When she's put on the spot, what about Saudi Arabia, the Khashoggi incident? Saudi Arabia killed 3,000 Americans on American soil. Saudi Arabia is killing immigrants at the border, mowing them down with machine guns, throwing mortars at them and blowing them up as they're trying to come across the border. She knows all this, but she says, oh, well, now the crown prince there, he's different than Putin. Really? And that's how she tries to justify everything she does. She is nothing more than a war pimp. She would be an awful president. And the very fact that she had any movement after that, I was so glad to see Ramaswamy say, really? You know, when you leave here, you're going to be on the board of Boeing and you're going to be making more millions of dollars. She is a useless politician where it comes to anything that's good for this country. And that shows up when you look at her history. Goes from a 2,000 square foot rental to a 5,000 square foot mansion in less than 2 years.
You know, just while you're talking about Saudi Arabia.
$5 million.
Yeah, worth bringing up. Over the weekend, they sentenced a man to death for I think 5 tweets that he sent out critical of the government. He's going to die for 5 tweets.
Yeah, MBS or nutcase. If you're wondering how bad crime's becoming in California, here's the perfect example. Recently, a city councilman was talking to the press in front of a camera, talking about crime and how bad it is and how why people are leaving California. While he's talking about it, he has his belongings stolen from him. Well, I mean, you know, this story, every time we talk about it, we get the email, oh, you're just making this up about Cal. It's overwhelming now. You know, you've got these gangs showing up and going into malls and basically taking whatever the hell they want and getting out of town. So now what's happening is you have this exodus. You have the big line stores that are leaving. They're saying, there's no solution to this. There's no police. We've accomplished what we want. We've lowered the number of police. We don't have anybody to stop this in California right now. This story tells the whole was it Emmyville?
Yeah. he's talking to the press. He's talking to the business owners. He's trying to kind of ease their fears. You know, we're going to make it better. We're working on this. And then he turns around and, all right, all my stuff, my car keys, my wallet has been taken from me while I'm sitting here trying to tell you we're going to handle the crime problem. So, it just Saturday Night Live could not have written a skit that reflects this any better. I mean, this is almost parody at this point. They're being robbed while talking to the press.
It's L.A. It's San Francisco. This little town is Emeryville. I don't know where the hell Emeryville is. But the story comes out, and you know, the headlines on Emeryville, for example, were that there was a mob of teens that had the folks working at Bath and Body Works in the storage part of the store fighting for their lives. They were worried about being killed by the mob of teens that were coming in. That's apparently how that was what the story reported anyway.
Yeah.
And so as this is going on, I think what you're seeing is you're seeing people getting the hell out of town. I mean, you know, the question is, how long can you ignore it? How long can you say this really isn't happening? What's your take on it? I mean, am I overstating that? If I am, please correct it.
No, it really has gotten to that point, especially you've got some malls in California that say, listen, we're not going to allow children in here anymore because it's not safe for your children to be in the mall. Mm-hmm. Because there is a risk that a mob, and we're not talking about a group of 20 or 30 people. These are groups of roughly, you know, about 1,000 people at a time that are coming into these stores, and it's almost like a flash mob. They show up immediately, take what they can, and they leave.
Okay, so the store says there's nothing we can do about it. We're just going to leave town. And so what you're going to have in California is a bunch of dollar stores, thrift shops. You're going to have the big line people saying, this isn't worth it. I mean, we can do business in other places. We don't need to be in California. And it's taken place. It's not just, if this were only one or two stories that we saw, we wouldn't even be doing this story. But this is almost a weekly story, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And part of the issue, too, is we've got to find out the root causes. Why is this suddenly happening? What is with all of this sudden retail theft?
Because
here?
They can. Because they can. Now,
are the economic conditions for these people just so bad to the point? Have they been squeezed to the point where they feel this is the only option? Because we've talked, I mean, God, 10 years ago, mm-hmm. the index, and I can't remember the name of it, but it talked about how when a society hits a certain point of inequality, it always leads to this kind of chaotic revolution, the increase in crime and all of that. And it makes me wonder, and I wish I could find that
well,
index
again. Well, we did a couple of stories on it. We interviewed some people on it, and the end, it was pretty convincing kind
of
argument.
They told us then, they said, we're right on that cusp, and maybe we've hit it.
Well, and, you know, we did the story last week where the billionaires, of course, are building their billionaire city right outside places like Emeryville, right? And they're going to have their billionaire city built, the city on the hill, and looking down in Emeryville and San Francisco and L.A., and saying, you know, y'all get by the best you can. We're putting up our gates. And there could be that division. I don't rule it out. I just think my first inclination is they're doing it because they can get away with it right now. At least at some point, somebody's got to, they've got to look at some of the most deep-rooted problems that are bringing this about. The Hawaii State Supreme Court's office is fielding dozens of complaints from residents in Maui who say that they're being preyed upon by unscrupulous lawyers from out of state. Local lawyers are now warning clients to use caution, these tourist lawyers, as they don't have to play by the same rules in Hawaii. We've done a couple of stories that, full disclosure, we work with a lawyer in Hawaii because we kind of have a specialty in this kind of thing, but we're not over there soliciting cases, but there are people that apparently are from New York, California, Florida.
Yeah, or Oregon, pretty much Texas, everywhere. You know, you've talked about these lawyers come and they parachute in, and what they're doing, according to these people in Maui who are filing these complaints, is they said, listen, this lawyer came up to me and said, hey, listen, I'll take your case. Don't you worry about it. Just give me partial ownership of your property, yeah. You know, a 10% stake in your own home, you know, exorbitant lawyer fees and all kinds of, you know, and the people are freaked out. They say, whoa, whoa, this is not at all how a lawyer is supposed to behave. No. And so the Supreme Court's disciplinary panel is saying, listen, these aren't our Hawaii lawyers. And so unfortunately, we can't do anything. And that's the scary part, because you can have these lawyers from out of state come in there and they don't have to necessarily abide by the same rules that the Hawaii lawyers
ultimately
do.
They can get the lawyer that's doing that if there's fraud involved. It doesn't make any difference where they live. They're going to be able to do something about it. But I mean, the first reaction is we had the same thing happen with every hurricane that happens around here. And when we were asked to get involved in Hawaii, my first reaction was, well, we don't practice in Hawaii. We don't have a license. We do practice in most places all over the country. I've tried cases in most states, as a matter of fact. But the thing to do is to have a local lawyer. Like, we have one that we work with as a local lawyer, and they're responsible to those clients on the ground. And so that's what you want to ask. You want to ask, well, where are you from, buddy? You're from New York? Who are you working with over here? And so there's an easy solution. People just need to be aware of it.
Well, and to point out, too, you know, you with your firm, y'all are working with the local lawyer because they've asked you for your expertise.
Right.
They've asked you for help, just like happens all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
You may not be handling the cases, but you know, you and your firm are seen as, you know, one of the top in this country.
Yeah.
So people reach out to you every day just saying, hey, advise on this, advise on that. Mm-hmm. And so that's a lot of what this is.
Yeah, it is. And they're just trying to skip a step. They're trying to freeze out the local lawyer and just do it themselves. And you know, I hope the Supreme Court keeps pounding on them about it. Victims who were abused at a boarding school in West Virginia recently won a hefty settlement, but the money doesn't wipe away the suffering. These students were sent to school because they were troubled teens, as they put it, and they were abused, and they were subjected to some of the worst treatment that you can imagine. Just a note, in Vegas, Las Vegas, I hold two times a year. I bring in thousands of lawyers from all over the country, and we have these meetings where we talk about kind of pivotal issues. We did that with tobacco when we started the tobacco case. We did it with opioids when we started the opioid case. We did it with human trafficking. We did it with PFAS. So twice a year, these lawyers come in from all over the country, and we talk about issues that are pivotal issues, societal issues, and we try to get them involved in the litigation to try to push back. This is one I'm bringing in Paris Hilton. She's going to open the program with me in Vegas. Paris Hilton, people don't understand, she was hugely abused in these types of facilities. Four different facilities she was sent to, abused in every one of them. And so she's kind of the face of it right now. She's doing a great job getting the word out there. But this case is just a typical kind of case, isn't it?
It really is. And so what we had here was this Miracle Meadows, you know, is partially religious, founded, you know, with a religious intent. And they said, send us your troubled teens. They opened up in 1988. And then immediately the abuse starts. The people who were sent here, you know, because the parents couldn't handle them, they were a little too rowdy, said we were forced into labor. We were shackled, handcuffed to our beds. We were put in isolation for long stretches of time, not just hours, but days and days, locked in these little boxes. They were sexually assaulted. There's been plenty of evidence that several of the women that were sent here were got pregnant. Yeah, yeah, from the guards. It was just horrific.
Starvation.
Abuse. Starvation. Yeah.
Well, here's the problem. We're already handling some of these cases. This same fact situation is taking place really in every place in the union. It's the same formula because it's corporate. Okay, you have corporations that have moved into this space because it's so lucrative. They're making so much money. The state doesn't really pay much attention to it. They take command of the regulators that are supposed to be overwatching this. They kind of make all the rules. And when it becomes as corporate as it is, when it becomes a multi-billion dollar corporate entity, which is what it is, this just continues, gets worse and worse.
And especially when you have these ones, you know, it's definitely different than where Paris Hilton was with her boarding schools. But when you have the schools for the, you know, so-called troubled teens, it's so much harder for those kids to come forward with these allegations of abuse because they've already been written off.
Yeah.
You know, oh, well, you're there because you're a problem anyway. How can we trust you? We don't believe you. And it makes the abuse so much
the
worse,
parents
too.
Don't. They've got it down to such a science that the parents don't believe that the abuse has taken place a lot of times. There was a great documentary done about Paris Hilton, and we're going to be talking about that documentary in Vegas. Just next month is when this is going to take place. But in that documentary, she confronts her mother. And, you know, it's almost as if her mom wants to say, I just didn't know anything. I didn't know what you were going through. And what she went through was horrible. And so anyway, we're going to, my goal is to have lawyers that come into this meeting, leave that meeting, go to their states, and try to do something about the problem in their states, just like we did on tobacco, just like we did on opioids, just like we did on PFAS, just like we did on human trafficking. And this is the place, this is the meeting place where that takes place. It takes place April and October every year and has for 25 years. That's where you see these new cultural, they're not new anymore because we've been doing it for so long, but these cultural, what I call cultural change pieces of litigation, that's where they originate. Republicans in Congress are ramping up their threats of impeachment against President Biden for being involved in crooked business deals with his son. And a new analysis says that Hunter Biden talking points are starting to take a little bit of a toll on Biden's reelection campaign. I'm not so sure. We talked earlier about, you know, a new article came in today. It was equivocal. Does it have an impact? I don't know that it does by itself. I think it's a cumulative aspect. I mean, it's just one other brick in the wall. You add everything together where they're talking about secret email names that are moving between Hunter and Joe, talking about dozens of offshore bank accounts that they're trying to follow, talking about shell corporations that are being put together, shell accounts, $50 million changing hands. Well, you hear those one-liners, and you hear them related to this story, and then the first reaction is where there's smoke, there's fire, right?
Usually. I mean, we've had, you know, smoking gun witness after smoking gun witness show up in Congress this year, and every time, okay, well, it's a big fat dud. Well, okay, but the next witness. I mean, it got to the point where Fox News even started calling out the Republicans in the House, like, listen, y'all have nothing. So, listen, I've said every time we talk about Hunter Biden, I always like to point this out. I don't care. If he did something, great. Let's go ahead and we'll prosecute. We'll go through the justice system and let it be handled. If not, wonderful. Let's move on from this. But so far, I haven't seen evidence. And it's just like, because
That list I just read, that list is what you're hearing.
Yes.
And you're saying this list doesn't amount to anything?
We don't have evidence of it.
Yeah.
Those are the talking points right now.
Right.
And the 50 million, you know, used to be 20 million. It actually started at 2 million. So that number keeps going up. But we still don't have anything that they tell us every week, like we're gonna have it, we're gonna have it, and it just never.
Did the shell accounts not bear out these shell accounts were put in different names?
Have not provided any kind of documentation that shows who was associated with what.
And how about the emails? Has that developed at all?
Not that I've seen with the emails so far. In fact, what we've heard from the witnesses who've come in, even the ones who say, yeah, Hunter Biden was kind of a shady guy, but I'll tell you, his dad wasn't involved in any of this. His dad's just on the phone talking to him about the weather, no idea. But they would say, yeah, Hunter did use his dad's presence to kind of intimidate people, but Biden himself was not aware that this was happening.
I'm not sure that the Hunter Biden issue alone moves anything. I think it's another, it's just another brick in the wall. It's with, you know, it's with all this other stuff that Biden is under attack about. And I just think, I don't think there's any one event that does it. I think it is a cumulative process. And I don't think you'll find any polling that says, yeah, people react and say, because of Hunter Biden, who, by the way, is not, you know, he's not in government. He's just a thug. You know, truthfully, he is a dirtbag thug in every sense of the word. But they've never really tied it up to Joe. And you're saying that there's nothing that does that right now?
Nothing concrete, obviously. Mm. I mean, look, you've even got Republicans in the Freedom Caucus, which is the far right group, that have come out and said, listen, we're wasting our time if we're going down this impeachment route. Mm. But they're going to go down it because they've made the commitment. They've backed themselves into a corner, so they have to. And if they find something, I'm not going to be like the Trump people and throw a temper tantrum and start whining on social media or storm the Capitol. If you find something, pursue
exactly.
it. Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean,
we're not that tribal.
I wish they would do that with Trump and say, look, you know, buddy, enough is enough. I mean, yeah, just take a break. We're going to run somebody else. Step aside. And that's what I want to, I already want to say that about Biden, but he seems intent on wanting to run. But I just think if it becomes too big of a problem, leadership in the Democratic Party has got to say, look, Joe, it's time to step down. We're going to put somebody else up there. Who it is, you name it. I don't have any idea at this point.
Well, I think it kind of speaks volumes to the Democratic Party itself, the fact that they're letting this Hunter Biden narrative go all throughout the media. Mm. Whereas you got Clarence Thomas, who is corrupt as hell, and we're finding out news stories every week. You got Jared Kushner and his $2 billion from Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the second he leaves office, obviously Trump's 91 felony charges. And Hunter Biden's you guys have so much to work with, and you're not talking about any of it.
Yeah.
Like, what is wrong with the party?
Yeah.
Get out there on it.
Yeah. Both sides have plenty to talk about, I can tell you that. Disgraced former lawyer Michael Avenatti recently suffered a humiliating defeat from an appellate court as he tried to get his prison sentence overturned. Avenatti is going to be spending a long time behind bars for a variety of different reasons. And this is the guy who the media once hyped and Democrats embraced. Oh, this is our future. This guy, do you remember that?
I mean, yeah.
Running for president, don't you remember? My God, we did a show on him. And we got all of this fan mail about Avenatti, how he is he's the bright new future of the Democratic Party. It's hero worship.
Yeah.
And both sides do it. My God, Trump hero worship. But here they were willing to jump and hug this guy, embrace him, because he talked bad about Trump. That's all it was. He talked bad about Trump, therefore he's the future of the Democrat. Do you remember that?
Oh, 100%.
I remember Avenatti writing to you, attacking you, because we were calling me a dirtbag back then. Do you remember that? I mean, before any of this happened, we had inside information that was already showing that he was ripping off clients. He was committing fraud with his clients, because this is our business. We knew what a dirtbag he was, so we started doing the dirtbag stories. And our people started writing comments to us like, how dare you? This is the future of the Democratic Party. Do you remember that? Or is that just my imagination?
I remember all of it. I frequently actually go back and look at that message that he sent me, because it is so just absolutely insane.
Did he threaten to sue you? Or sue me, sue you, sue all of us?
Yeah, it was a lot of, you know, how dare you call yourself a lawyer, which I don't, because I'm not. But it was just so vile and crazy.
Yeah.
And that was, you know, one of the real first impressions of this guy. That was before we knew about all of the fraud he was committing. And again, there was a time, there was like a year and a half span.
Oh,
you couldn't turn on MSNBC or CNN
stupid.
Without seeing his big dumb face.
Oh, my God. You know, he'd be up there with Rachel Maddow, Rachel, who I used to do a program with for a long time, you know, acting like this is the bright new future. During a time when we had his picture up here, calling him a dirtbag punk, because we knew what he was really about.
Well, and, you know, what's funny is, yeah, he was the guy. He was going to be the next leader of the Democratic Party. And then when he fell from grace, everybody said, okay, well, it's going to be Cuomo next.
Yeah.
So maybe stop moving on so quick, because it's not working out so well.
It's hero worship, isn't it?
It is. I mean, anybody who stands up to Trump.
Do you understand it? Do you understand the whole hero worship? Because as hard as I try, I can't, I guess my basis to say maybe it happens because we expect so little, don't we?
We do. We really do. Because all it took was this guy saying, hey, I'm taking Trump to court. And everybody said, well, we love you.
He was stealing millions from his clients. One client, I remember in particular, paralyzed, completely paralyzed, stole his money, stole Stormy Daniels' money, committed fraud against Nike. All this was happening, and we saw the edge of it before anybody else did and said, this is a punk dirtbag. What in the hell are you Democrats doing saying, that's going to be our next Democratic guy, our president? They literally were talking like that.
Well, he gets out of jail and 2036, that is a presidential election year, so yeah. We'll see if he runs that year.
Farron, thanks for joining me. That's all.
Thank you.
That's all for this week, but all these segments are going to be available throughout next week. And make sure you follow us at Twitter at America's Lawyer. I'm Mike Papantonio, and this has been America's Lawyer, where we tell you the stories that corporate media won't tell you because their advertisers don't let them, or their political connections, whether Democrat or Republican, don't allow for it. We'll tell you these stories, whether you get mad at us or not, telling the stories. We're going to tell the stories, and we're not going to change that. So understand, it is who we are. We're not tribal. We don't have a party. We tell it right down the middle. We'll see you next time.